Hello and welcome back to this lecture series on the Hindu view of life, a profound philosophical work by Dr. S. Radhakrishnan. It is a timeless treatise on what constitutes the Hindu way of life. In the previous lecture, we discussed the first chapter, which was titled Religious Experience, Its Nature and Content. Here, Dr. Radhakrishnan very elaborately explains how the Hindu religion originated and developed. He opines that the term Hindu is not a creedal term. It does not signify any, it is not a statement of own religious beliefs. Rather, it had a territorial significance because the term was given by the outside settlers here. To the people who lived on the Indian side of the Sindhu River. So in this chapter, he opines that Hinduism is neither a sectarian creed and nor is dogma ridden. It is not authoritative, it is not incontrovertible, and it does not believe in absolutism like the other religions, for example, Christianity of the world. Rather, Hinduism or Hindu religion is very flexible. It is an experimental religion. It is scientific and it is open to other points of view. And this religion is not static. It says that it is steadily growing and evolving religion. It is fluid. It is flexible. And it continuously moves like a river. And now, for this, the criticism has been done by the Western intellectuals that this religion believes in polytheism and it is outdated religion. But here Radhakrishnan says that though Hinduism accepts multiple images of God, but all these images merge into one ultimate supreme reality of Brahma. So we can say that it is a vast, complex, but subtly unified mass of spiritual thought and realization. In Hinduism, the truths of life are revealed through spiritual or religious experience, which he calls intuition. So he refutes all the criticism and asserts that Hinduism is one of the most sublime religions of the world. It has stood the test of time. Though it seems to be a confusing tangle of myths with many different gods and goddesses, who are worshipped in countless forms. But beneath this superficial expression, we can find a unifying belief that has guided the lives of ordinary people in the country for generations. And he explains in this chapter the concepts which are intrinsic to Hindu philosophy of life. Now, let's move to the second chapter, which is titled as Conflict of Religions, the Hindu Attitude. In this chapter, he wants to point out that there are different facets of one reality. And though different religions of the world have inherent differences in the formulation of mystical experiences, but there is an underlying universality behind these experiences. Throughout the world, the mystics believe in the oneness of God. Here he says that a seer doesn't attach importance to the outward forms. And who is a seer? He says that true seer is gifted with a universality of outlook. A true seer is one who has seen the radiant vision of divine. And a seer's consciousness is anchored in God, and it cannot deny an expression of life as utterly erroneous or wrong. A seer is convinced of the inexhaustibility of the nature of God and the infinite number of his possible manifestations. Here, to endorse his point of view, Radhakrishnan quotes from the intellectual representations in various cultures, harping upon the oneness of God. He quotes here from Plato to Indian rishis of Upanishadic traditions, Tagore, Gandhi, Sufi saints, all of them offer different accounts, but he says that not one of them is full or final. For example, he says that Sufism compares this mystic God expression to different shapes of wine container, and the purpose of all of these containers is to contain the wine. So we see that ultimately the overall perspective towards the ultimate reality God is that God is one. Now let's move to the next part. He tells us that Hinduism is flexible and tolerant of other creeds. So he says that Hinduism isn't a fanatic faith. It is not an inflexible creed. And neither it is dogmatic. It is not obsessed with the thought that the acceptance of a particular religious, mystic, metaphysics is necessary for salvation, and non-acceptance thereof is a heinous sin meriting eternal punishment in hell. So the main note of Hinduism is one of respect and goodwill for other creeds. So we see here that Hinduism believes in comprehensive charity, respect and goodwill for other religions of the world and other creeds. This is the main note of Hinduism on which it has survived all through ages. Now Radhakrishnan regards Hinduism as the first missionary religion of the world. Though he says that the mission here is not to convert the other people, other religion or the humanity to any one opinion. So Hinduism is different from the Christian missionaries. The Christian missionaries tried to convert the entire world to their own point of view, to their own thoughts. But Hinduism is not so restrictive or so authoritative. Rather, it is a religion of reconciliation, it is a religion of assimilation, which incorporates all that is good in other religion and which is true in other religion, as well as it also incorporates that is evil or erroneous. But in the Hindu religion, a constant effort is made to throw out the unsatisfactory elements. So we can say that Hinduism is a large and comprehensive unity. It has a large and comprehensive unity of living organism, and it has a fixed orientation. In it, we can say that the polytheism or the belief in the multiple gods and goddesses was organized in a monistic way. But this monotheism was not rigid or intolerant. So he proves his point. He gives here as examples and very extensively he gives us illustrations from Hindu scriptures like Bhagavad Gita, Rig Veda, Atharva Veda and epics. And so he confirms that Hinduism is a religion. As I have said, told you earlier, it is a religion of reconciliation and assimilation. That is, it does not deny the other religions or other points of view of the world, rather it assimilates all of them into one. And by this assimilation, it believes in transforming the other thought processes, other religions. So we can say that the Hindu method of religious reform is essentially democratic, because it allows each group to set to the truths through its own traditions. It absorbs all the religions into itself, because he says that God exists in everything. So we can say that Hinduism absorbs everything into it and then raises it to a higher level. It brings out a change in its content, not merely in their names. So this is the Hindu way of bringing about the religious reform. And he discusses elaborately in this chapter about this Hindu solution to the conflict of religions in the world. He says that Hinduism believes in a transformation through suggestion and persuasion. The Hindu people or Hindu religious leaders, they do not believe in force, because he believes that, Radha Krishna says here, that the Hindu religious reformists, the aim of these reformers should be to cure the defect, not to criticize the view. Thus, it leads to the realization of the incorporate supreme or God by altering the bias of mind. So, here we can say that Hinduism has an upper hand over the other religions of the world, because it does not show its absolute authority, and neither it accepts the absolute authority of any other religion or other point of view. And he says that for a Hindu, the differences in name become immaterial, as every name is used indiscriminately for the absolute reality, which we call God, and it connotes the same metaphysical and moral perfections. So Hinduism believes in gradual but continual evolution, as subconscious heritage cannot be altered suddenly. Hindu method of reform, we can say here, it enables every group to retain its past associations and preserve its individuality and interest. But here the Hinduism, Hindu thought has been criticized by the Western philosophers as being indifferent. This tolerance, this acceptance of other religion, this assimilation has been criticized by the Western critics, Western philosophers, as indifference. But we can say that it is not so, because Hindu religion is very sympathetic and helping in the spiritual growth of the lesser beings without interfering in their natural way of thinking. And this natural way of thinking, Dr. Krishnan says, depends on the person's moral and intellectual gifts, his or her education and environment. So we can say that Hinduism believes in gradual and continual evolution rather than taking rapid strides, which may prove disastrous, because we have seen in the history of the world that the intolerance, the religious intolerance, has caused a lot of bloodshed over ages. So Hinduism does not believe in exclusive absolutism, because it is inconsistent with an all-loving universal God. Because God does not discriminate between people. God's love is for everyone. It is equally spread all over the world. So if the people of the religious leaders become exclusive. They believe in absolutism. They try to impose their own thoughts over the people with the different perspectives, different religious beliefs. Then this intolerance causes bloodshed. This intolerance causes enmity in the world. It is not, it does not have any unifying force. So all these concepts of Dr. Krishna leads him to elaborating on the concept of religion. What does religion mean? Here he tries to define it. What is religion? He says that religion is righteous living. Mark this word, that religion is righteous living. It is a way of life on principles. It is not the right living, rather it is the righteous living. Religion is not the correct belief. And religion believes in conduct. Religion does not believe in creed. So Hinduism gives regard to everyone's individuality, because all peculiarity is unique and incommunicable. Hinduism is against reaching on oneness forcibly, as it is against nature of reality. Dr. Radhakrishnan here distinguishes religious consciousness and other professions of the world. Here he says that the outer professions, they have no roots in inner life. That is, we pursue our careers in life to earn money. So he says that all these outer professions, whatever profession we adopt, it does not reach our inner life. It has no roots there. We cannot alter suddenly our subconscious heritage at the bidding of the reformer. So he wants to say that religious beliefs, religious thoughts, they are embedded in the very soul of a human being, and these cannot be changed at the bidding of any reformer suddenly. The old ideas cannot be rooted out unless we are educated to a higher intellectual and moral level. So this is the principle of tolerance, which is adopted in Hindu religion. And that's why Hindu religion, we can say that the Hindus are the peace-loving people, and they do not believe in any sort of friction. Now again, Hindu thought has been criticized by the Westerners as being imperfect, and here Dr. Krishnan also accepts that Hindu method cannot be called that it is perfect, and people have alleged against Hinduism that the Hindu plan has not helped its adherent to a freer and longer life. But Hindu method, we can say that it is not altogether failure. Despite various creeds and worship forms, it has an inner coherence. And it has an inner cohesion also, and a common scheme. Of course, we can say that there is some neglect in recent past in the task of uplifting the uncivilized people. But Hinduism does not support any sort of sophism. What is sophism? It is the very cleverly given false arguments to deceive somebody. So in Hinduism, there is not such type of hypocrisy. Here, Dr. Radhakrishnan draws our attention towards the intolerance and narrow monotheism adopted by the different religions of the world. He says that because of this monotheism and intolerance, we have seen, history have seen bloodbaths, but Hinduism does not endorse any sort of fanaticism and persecution for disbelief, as is done in Islam and Christianity. The tolerance of Hindus and Buddhist rulers allowed all the religions, whether it is Christianity or the Parsis or the Jewish people, to develop in India on their own lines. So, Dr. Krishnan opines that tolerance of other beliefs and the diversity of religious thoughts is needed for religious unity and peace. And to achieve peace, we have to accept Hindu solution. And what is Hindu solution? It seeks the unity of religions, not in common creed, but in common quest. That is, it does not ask to have one common viewpoint. Rather, he says that our quest, our search should be common. That is directed towards the ultimate reality of the world, that is directed towards the Supreme Soul. So, he further says that Hinduism is a comprehensive religion which believes in synthesis, which believes in harmonious coexistence, and he finds out only in Hinduism the solution to the world's disintegration. And he says that this solution lies in Hindu tolerance. So he says that we should look at different religions not as incompatibles, but we should look at them as complementaries. That is, they stand by each, they complete each other, and they are indispensable to each other for the realization of the common end. And what is that common end? As I have told you again and again, that common end is the search for the ultimate reality of the world. That is the Supreme Soul. And he says, more and more religious we grow, the more tolerant of diversity a person becomes. So, with this, we come to an end to our discussion here. So, we have seen through our discussion that these chapters, or Radha Krishnan views, in these lectures, he present a very rational and impartial account of Hindu religion. And here he very comprehensively and elaboratively discussed what Hinduism stands for and what are the differences between Hinduism and other religions of the world. But we have seen that Dr. Radha Krishnan very wisely avoided the unnecessary criticism of other religions. So he says that we should feel proud of being Hindus, and we should feel, we should know that Hinduism is known for its flexibility, its tolerance, its democratic and scientific approach, and it is the best solution of the religious conflicts of the world. So we can say that Hinduism is certainly the superior to the other sectarian religions of the world for its comprehensive and synthetic spirit. And in the end, we can say that though Hinduism has many sects, many subsects, various darshanas or branches of philosophy, to develop a clear understanding of what Hinduism stands for and what is the Hindu way of life, it is a great challenge before us, because it is full of many thoughts and many darshanas in it. So with this, we come to an end to this discussion, and the next you will see the discussion on the next chapters in the separate videos. This is the reference book. You can consult this book, The Hindu Way of Life by HarperCollins Publishers, India. Thank you very much.